Hello, I'm trying to make this video so that I can show you how we can develop a questionnaire in Cobo Toolbox. All right, we are going to start from the very beginning. We'll be using a different questionnaire than the one we were using last time. So I'm hoping after this video, you get to see how you can develop a questionnaire from start to the end. And okay, let me just show you the questionnaire which I'm using right now. Right, this is the questionnaire I'm using, and it's household profiling questionnaire, and I have attached it along with the email that I have sent to you, notifying you of this video and other information about the training as well. So this is a questionnaire. It's a simple questionnaire whereby it's just collecting, we're calling it household profiling, because we're just collecting information about households. That's the whole idea here. All right, so what we want to do is we'd like to get this questionnaire into Cobo Toolbox, and then we'll see how we can synchronize this questionnaire, or that is deploy it first, and then synchronize it with the ODK Collect mobile app, and then how we can collect data and how that data can be sent over to the server, that is to Cobo Toolbox. And I'm actually going to show you the connections of events, how things are coming from your questionnaire, paper questionnaire, or digital questionnaire in PDF or Microsoft, like I have here, to Cobo Toolbox, to actually collecting data, even if you have different teams that are collecting data, how you can actually bring all that together. So before I go to Cobo Toolbox here, I'm just going to go through this questionnaire, pointing out a few things that you need to understand from this questionnaire. All right. Typical questionnaires have a section that is basically trying to identify each of the data points or data units. In this case, our data unit is a household. Okay, your data unit could be a person, that is a respondent. It could be a subject. For example, if you are doing experimental things, and your data point would be, let's say, a plant, if that's your subject. And in this case, our data point is a household. So this questionnaire is trying to collect information about households. Now, we would like to identify each of the households on its own. That's why we have this section up here called with identification items. You may have only one question there. For example, usually you just have questionnaire number or household number, but I decided that, okay, let's have district, village, and household number. Okay, that's the section. And then we have section A. Section A, if you look at it, it says that this is a section A of household composition. And we are being told here to use the first row to record the details of the household head. Now, if you look at this question, household composition, you will see that, sorry, not this question, but this section of household composition, one thing you will understand is that it is a roster. How do we know that this is a roster? It's because these are our questions. One, two, three, four, five, six. Here you have household member name. What is the relationship of house of this person to the household head? Is this person male or female? And then we have rows. We have rows where we would like to now enter our data. So this is where we would want to enter our data. Now, the idea here is that for each of for each of these rows or each of these individuals, remember these are the individuals in the household. So for each of these individuals, we are collecting this information, or we are collecting these variables here. So these questions are repeating. So because all these questions are repeating for each of these people in the household, then this one is actually a roster. Remember that the data unit for this questionnaire is a household. We are asking about the household. But for this section now, we're not asking about the household. We're asking for each of the persons, in the household. So since we may have more than one person in the household, so it means that these questions here are repeating for each of the people that we are going to record here. That's what makes this question or this section a roster. If you look at Section B is household economic status. You just have these questions: how many people live in the household? We are now straying back to asking about the household in general. So, how many people live in the household? Of this, how many actively contribute to the income of the family? Which of the following are your household sources of income? And you have all these here. How much income did you get from these sources last year? And you have all these other questions. And then you have all these other questions. And then we have, I will now ask you about the items in your home and their value. So you have different items, how many available for each of the item, and the current total value of each of the items. And then we have this housing section where you're talking about how many rooms does your house have, how does your household dispose refuse, and so on. And we only have four questions in that section, and that's the end of the questionnaire. So what I'm going to do is, first of all, I'm going to start by creating the ID items and then continue that way. So let's start. ID items, we have district, village, and household number. So I hop over to my COBOL toolbox, to COBOLtoolbox.org. So I go to get started, okay? And then I click on sign up or login. So I click there. And then I have to log in. Those are my details. I click login. And here I am with my questionnaires. Now, like I said last time when we met, we have this section. The first section here, which is highlighted as you can see, is now form projects. These are the form projects. I have 1, 2, 3, 4 form projects that have been deployed. And then I have this one, which is just draft. In other words, it hasn't been deployed yet. And then I have this section for which is the library, which where I can save questions. And then you have this section, which is now the aggregator. In other words, where the data resides when we deploy these questions. Okay, I'm just going to go straight to creating my new form. So to create my new form, I click on new and new form. And this screen comes up and I have to write the name of the form. So the name of this form is simply going to be Household Survey. I'll just call it Household Survey, just like that. Okay. Then I click Create. Create. All right. Now, here, when you click Create, you have to make sure that this button turns to Save. All right, so the create should go and then you should have saved. That way, you are sure that things are working. In other words, the questionnaire has been created, and now when we make changes, we simply have to click save. Okay, so the next thing I have to do is go straight to creating questions. So I just come here and click this plus and type my first question, which is district. So I'll simply say district. Okay. District, and then add question. Here, I just have to decide what type of variable is this? What way of capturing the information is it going to be? Is it going to be a select one? In other words, do I have values whereby the user or the one who is asking the question is going to select one of the options? Or is it select many? In other words, the user can select several items, okay, out of a list of items. That is, if the question is actually multiple response question. Is it a text variable? In other words, do you want people to just type in text? Okay, this is especially when you have names. Is it a number? Is it wanting a number whereby people just put a number? For example, in household income, that's going to be a number. Specifically, not household income, because if household income is going to have decimals, then we are going to say it's a decimal variable. But if it's a discrete number, for example, number of people in the household, and so on, then you would say that's a number. But if it's a household income, anything that has to do with income, anything that can have decimal points, then you say that's a decimal. If it's a debt, and there you are. If it's time, there you are. If it's asking for both date and time, here you are. And then if you want to record GPS, here you are. And a note there, GPS collects both, actually three things. It collects your latitude, longitude, and altitude. So you don't have to create two different or three different fields. Once you select GPS, then there you have it. It's just going to collect GPS. If you want to capture a photo, this is where to go. If you want to capture an audio, this is where to go, and so on. All right, we have gone through this, and you have a guide which can take you through explanations of all these data types. If you think about district, okay, I guess it would be good for us to, since one person can only be in one district, so that would be a select one. But then, why I've chosen select one instead of having people to type the text is because typing text could give you different things. In the case that people if someone says Chikwawa and someone says Chikwawa, and you tabulate that, or you conduct some analysis, it will come up like as if those two districts are not the same. So that might bring you problems in statistics. So it's best that you pass or you provide the list of options. So I click select one right there, and there it gives me these boxes where I have to add my items. So for example, in district, I have Chikwawa here. And then I have Sanje. Okay, I have two here, so I can click to add more. So here, this one is going to be Mwanza. This one is going to be Blanta. This is going to be Cholo, and then Chiradzulu, and then Molanje. All right, I'm just going to leave it here. Now, I recommend this data, if you want it at a certain point to analyze it in SPSS, I'll recommend for the values, you come here and you replace the values. I'm just double-clicking and typing my number. Double-click and type the number, just like that. Double-click and type the number. As fast as that. Make sure you're double-clicking the text, like that. Double-click, type the number. Double-click, type the number. Remember that this, if you click here, then you are adding another option. Don't make that mistake. This option, I'm just going to delete it like that. So we have it. Now that I've added one question, you see that this has filled in the whole space. So I can click this down arrow here. Okay, this chevron, it's called a chevron. And then so that I can collapse this question. Like that. Now it takes not all of the space. All right, I could be saving as I'm moving to avoid any horrors. Okay, let's click the plus to go to the next question. And the next question is village. So I just type village, click add question. For this one, I don't have the list of villages, so people just be typing the name of the villages, which means that is a name and that is a what? Yeah, great. That is actually text. So I click text, and text doesn't need any explanation. Thank you. The next one is household number. So I click the plus right here, and then I just type household number. And then click add question. I have to decide, is it a number or is it a decimal? These are households. So it would be number one, number two, with no decimal. So this is simply a number, and number doesn't need any explanation. Now, that means I have three questions. I'm just going to save again. Okay, I have three questions in here, which means I'm good. And I have finished the section for ID items. Now, watch what I do next. Once I've finished the section of ID items, what I want is I would like to group this. Okay, I would like to put these three into a group. So to group these three questions, it's just a matter of clicking the first one. When you're clicking, make sure that your cursor or your mouse pointer turns into a crosshair. A crosshair is a point four pointed arrow. So you have, you know, four pointed arrow like that. You click that, it will have a blue outline. Hit your control key on your keyboard and then click the next one. Please don't leave your control key and then click the next one. My control key is still down. You see, so all these three have been highlighted. So what I have to do is go on the toolbar here and click this icon. Can you see that icon? Yes, exactly. That's the icon. Create group with selected questions. All right. So I'm just going to click that and all these questions are in one group. All I have to do is click where it says group and delete that. Okay. Remember. Okay. Anyway, let's continue. I've clicked there and I would say identification items. Identification items. I would say identification section. Actually, let's say that this is a identification section. You see that? Pretty beautiful. Okay. Right. So before I continue, I want to show you something. That if when I point here, I have two pluses. The first plus looks like it's outside of the group, and the other plus is actually inside of the group. If I click this plus, I am going to add a question inside of this group. If I click the other one, the outer one, then I'm going to add a question outside of the group. All right, let me show you. I want to add a question inside of the group. Actually, I want a GPS. So I'm going to click this one inside here, and I'll just call it GPS, just like that. And I'll say add question, and this is GPS. Done. You see? So now I have finished the first section, the identification section. What I would do is I'll come here where I have this chevron here for the group and collapse it. This saves me space. You see that? Great. Let's continue. So now I have to go to the next section. You see, I'm done with this first section here. So I'm just going to scroll over. So this one says household member name and so on. Okay. First, before I go there, you see, we have this nice little information here, which says use the first row to record details of the household head. Okay, so I want to do that. So what I would do is I'll click to add a question like this. Okay, now this is not a question. This is just information that we are telling the person who is asking the questions. So this is how it will go. I would just say, the first occurrence should be the household head. You know, you can put it any way you want. We're just trying to tell this person that the first person to be recorded in this group should be the household head. So what would that be? I don't know if you got it right, but it sure has to be a not. Remember, a not is not a question. It's just information that you are trying to provide to these people, to the person who is collecting the data. So I click on the not, done. First occurrence should be the household. And this will just appear like just text, just instructions. All right. So I'm going to continue now. So the first question is household member name. So I click here and say, household member name. I want to put this into a question. So let's say, what's the name of the next household member? Just like that. and then we add question. This is, we're asking for a name. So what do you think would be the data type or the capture type? You got it right. It's actually text. So text needs no explanation. Done. That is done. The next question says, what is the relationship of this person? Remember, this is a roster. Okay, this is a roster. So what this means is that I'm recording this one. So I'll ask for the first one. Can you please give me a name of the of someone in the household? Okay, so it gives me Peter Peely. Now the next question, I'm saying, what is the relationship of Peter Peely to the household head? So it could be self, okay? It could be the himself or herself, or it could be any of other these other options. When I finish this row, and I would come back. So the same question pops up. What is the name of the next person in the household? So you say, okay, this is Martha P. All right. So what is the relationship of Martha P? Now Martha P to the household head. So this section here is going to be repeating. That's why it is a roster. Okay, let's continue. So I'm going back to Cobo Toolbox. So I'm saying that I would like to ask this question. What is the relationship of this person to the household head? Now, this is where we come with what you call the fields, all right? The label fields. The label fields, in other words, would like to get the value that has been answered or that has been inputted here, where it says, what's the name of the next household member? And grab it and put it into the next question. Okay, that's what we want to do. So we want to fill in this next question with the value of this question. Okay, so we are going to use the question referencing format in able to do that. Okay, question reference format, remember that? Dollar, open curly bracket, data column name, cause, close curly bracket. That's what we want to do. Now, before I go ahead, I would have to, for because I'll be capturing the data, data column name of this question, I'll go to the settings. Okay, when I go to the settings here, this is the data column name of this question. I just think this is too much. This is a lot. So what I would do, if I go to the question, I'll see that this question household member name has been given a code of A1. So I'm just going to use this code A1 here as the data column name of that question. So I don't have problems calling this question to appear here. Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to say, okay, this is A1. This is A1, just like that. And I'll close this. Okay. So what will happen is, because that's a data column name, then I can say, what is the relationship of $A1? To the household head. So I click the plus, I will say, what is the relationship of dollar, open curly bracket, A1, close curly bracket. Remember, A1 is this question here. So it's going to grab the value from there and just put it here. So if you have, what is the name of the next household member, the Peter Peely, then here there will be Peter Peely. Replaced. So of Peter P to the household head. Question mark. I add this question. If you look at this question, you see that it has a list of options and you can only select one, which means you get it. It's a select one. Ah, we are moving nicely here. Great. So what are the options? The options you have self, spouse, child. Let's put those. You have self. Okay, spouse and child. Continuing, what do you have? Parent, sibling, grandparent, parent, sibling, grandparent, grandchild, daughter, son, no other relative. Grandchild, son slash daughter in law, have a relative. And then the last one is non-relative. Okay, so what are the values? Okay, 1 up to 10. So I'll just put in the values here. 1, double click, 2, double click, 3, double click, 4, and so on. You see how simple it is? This is so easy. I'm very sure you're going to get this. I'm very, very sure about that. All right, so now I'm done. Then I can just, you know, just do that. And then I have saved space. So I continue. The next question is A3. Is name male or female? Okay, is name male or female? So this one was A2. This is A3. Is name male or female? Or we are putting the same value from household member name, putting it here. So remember, this is A1. So I still say, is $A1 male or female? On the data entry, it will say, for example, if there's Peter Petey here, then it will say, is Peter Petey male or female? So I click this. Is this male or female? It's going to be what? No, it's not going to be multiple response. I don't think someone will be actually male and female at the same time. It will be select one. So is, I still get that. So dollar, open curl bracket, A1, cross curl bracket, male or female, question mark. Add this. So like we have agreed. Oh my goodness. You see what happens? If you click that add and you click somewhere away, then it just goes. So I'm going to just do it again. Is dollar A1 male or female, question mark. So I click to add, and before I do anything, I have to select the capture type. This is a select one. So what are the options? Male, female. This is one. This is two. If you think I'm fast, it's just, you can just, you know, this is a video, so you can bring it back and so on. So I'm just going to collapse it and save as I go. Remember, save, no horror, no left, wrong 10. Okay, let's continue. Next question is date of birth. I'm not going to ask date of birth. I'm going to ask when was $A1 born. Okay, so when was $A1 born? That's the date. So I click to add a question, and what would be that? That would be date. Okay, because we want a date, so that will capture type would be date, no any other, you know, description and whatsoever. Okay, then the next question is $A1 married or not married. So let's do that. Married or not married, you cannot be both. No, you cannot be both. Contrary to popular opinion, you cannot be both. So is $A1 married or not married? Not married, question mark. So that is select one. We cannot be both. So select one. So what are the options? The options are married, not married. And I give it 1 and 2 there, just like that. And I collapse it. I'm continuing. All right, next one. What was this one, highest education attained? Okay, so I click the plus and I say, what was dollar? Remember, we're still calling the name A1. A1's highest education attained. Add question. So this is the what. If you look at this, you see that what was $A1's, there are a list of options where you can only select one. You can only select one. So what does that mean? That means it's a select one. Okay. So what are the options? Let's see. Underage. under H3, none. PSOCE MSCE college certificate, I guess. College diploma, bachelor's degree. I don't know what's bachelor about it. All right, bachelor's degree, master's degree, and then doctoral degree and other. I don't know if you have other after doctorate degree. What other could it be? What other could there be? All right, let me, now I'm going to add the values. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Is it like that? I don't think so. There's 9901. Okay, so this one is 99. So this one is 0. This is 1. Double click. 2. Double click. 3. Double click. 4. Double click. 5. Sorry. 5. Double click. 6. Double click. 7. Double click. 8. I think that's where it ends. 8. Thank you. That ends. So I'm going to do the same thing. Aha. So I'm finished. I'm going to click save here. So I have now finished creating questions for this group. So I want to group it. But before I group it, I need you to, you agree with me that this first question here, not a question, this is a not. The next section or the first occurrence should be the household head. Okay, actually, let's add some things here. Just in the next section, I am going to ask you about you and those that live with you in the household. Okay, in the household, like that. Then I'm just going to say not. The first occurrence should be the household head, like that. So you agree with me that this not here is not supposed to be repeated along with this. So we don't want for the next person in the next section, blah, blah, blah. And then for the second person in the next section. So I'm not going to put this in the same group as these other questions. Because when I put them in the same group, then it means that this question gets repeated along with these other questions. And that's not what I want. So what I do, I select the second one, all right? Okay, and then hit my control key on my keyboard, and I'm not leaving it. Click the next one, next one, next one, next one, next one. Let's see if you have the next one. No, we don't have. So right now you can see that all these have a blue outline, and I'm going to go on the toolbar again and click like that. So I've made a group, and I'm going to call this group household composition, like that. You see, now this question is outside, because now what will happen is in the next section I'm going to ask you about blah 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 blah, then the section now starts. You see, so what I have to do now at this point, these are just one question, and it's not going to repeat. So I have to go to the settings of the group here. Then I have the data column name of the set of the section. I have appearance, but I also have here where it says repeat. So I'm just going to put a check mark so that this group repeats if necessary. We only do this if the group is a roster. Well, I think we have agreed on that. This is a roster. We have agreed on that. So we repeat it for as many times as we have people in the household. So it's going to be repeating. Nice. We have done that, so I can exit the settings and collapse the group and save. So my questionnaire is moving very perfectly right here. All right, let's continue. So the next section is household economic status. Household economic status. Okay, the first question says, how many people live in the household? So let's continue. How many people live in the household? So I'm gonna click the plus, which is outside the group. So how many people live in the household, in this household? Question mark, add question. That's a what? That's a number. Thank you. Next question. Of this, how many actively contribute to the income of the family? To make matters easier, I'm just gonna copy this. Okay, so I'll click the plus and I'll paste. Okay, and I'll click add question. So of this number, how many? So this requires a number as well. So it's gonna be a number. That's it, done. Next question. Which of the following are your household sources of income? I'm just gonna copy this. So I click the plus to add this question. I paste it and click add question. So this question, again, it says, which of the following? If you look at the options clear, you see the salary from work, wages from piece work, sale of crops, okay? And sources of income, obviously, you would, okay, I would, okay, I get salary from work. I get wages from piece work. I sell crops. So I can actually put check marks on all this. This question is a multiple response question. So what is a multiple response question in ODK? It's a select many. So I put here select many, and my options are, let's go back, salary from formal work, the next one, wages from piecework, next one, sale of crops, next one, sale of livestock and livestock products, I think we got next one is pension. I'm just gonna add my values here, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Done. So I close that like so. The next question is, how much income did you get from these sources last year? So if you look at this question, this is not one question, because you have different sources and there's going to be amounts for each of the sources. Okay, so we're asking for amounts for each of the sources. So what will happen is I'll actually expand this question. So it sounds, how much income did you get from Sally from OIG? Okay. So I'm just gonna copy the starting part. How much income did you get from salary from work amount? How much income did you get from wages from piece work amount? I cannot say this is one question, because it's gonna be different answers for each of the items. I hope there we agree. Okay. So I click the plus. Okay, so how much income did you get from salary from formal work? This is last year. Add question. And this is gonna be a what? So salary from formal work, is it a number? What if you want to put decimal points? So let's make it decimal. So just to show you, I can actually just instead of creating new questions again, I can just duplicate this one. Remember, it's almost the same kind. So the next one is wages from piecework. So it's almost the same kind. So I can duplicate the first one. Okay. So if I duplicate this, I have a question like this, the same one. So how much income did you get from what? So from this time it's from wages from piecework. This is wages from piecework. So I'm just gonna come here and I'm going to from wages from piecework. I hope you got that. Did you get that? How much income did you get from salary from formwork? Now, how much income did you get from wages from piecework last year? You see, all these are the same. You see this here, 1.0? This is just telling you that this is a decimal. I'm adding the next one. Sale of crops. So, same kind of question. So I just duplicate the question. Then I click here. I will delete this from what? So this time along, it's from sale of crops. How much income did you get from sale of crops last year? It's going on well. Next one, sale of livestock and livestock products. I do the same. I simply duplicate this question and click here. Delete this part. From what? This time it's from sale of livestock and livestock products. You see that? Great. So duplicate this question for the last time, and this is pension. I'm not going to copy it. This is just a little. Now this time I click here on the label and say from what? From pension last year. Done. Done. This is how easy it gets. This is how easy it gets. You see that? Okay. Now we are on to this other question here. See, we're on to this other question. Now, this question has labels here. This question says, I will now ask you about the items in your home and their values. I want you to look at this question very carefully. Yes, you might be thinking, yeah, this is actually a roster. Now, the problem with this one is that we have labels on the left-hand side. And if you make this a roster, we will lose these labels. And we won't know that for the first one, we are talking about beds. For the next one, we are talking about radios. For the second, the other one, we are talking about, we won't be able to know that. Won't be able to know that. So, how do we deal with that? Okay. What we can do is we could simply flatten this table into a list. Do you know how to flatten a table into a list? Kind of like how we were doing with matrices. Remember matrices in mathematics? What do? We say this multiplied by that, this multiplied by that. Remember that? I think I'm right. But that's basically the whole idea. You say, how many beds are available? What's the total current value of beds? Then again, how many radios are available? Then current total value of radios. How many TVs available? Then current total value of TV. All those are going to be different variables. I know it's a mouthful, but it's necessary. It actually aids you as you're asking the questions even. So it's actually a good way of doing this. Okay? It's actually a very good way of doing what we are doing right now. Okay? Okay. So let's use that. Okay? Let's use that. So how many, we're starting with this bed. There's radio, TV, bicycle. So we're going to go there here. And then before I do this, I'm going just gonna ask, say, put this. I will now ask you about the items in your home and their values. You think you know what this is going to be? I hope you know what this is going to be. This is now getting these people ready for the next section. So that's a what? That's a not. Thank you. You got it right. It's a not. All right. So I'm just gonna put a not. This is a not that for the next section, I will ask you about the items in your home. Okay? I'll ask you for of the items in your home. Great. So let's start the first item. First item is bed. How many available and current total value? So I'll click plus and I'll say how many beds do you have? How many beds do you have? I add this question, it's a number. It's a number. So next question is, what is the current total value of the bets? Had a question? And this is a decimal. Why is it a decimal? It's money, you know, it's money. May have tambalas, you know. Someone will tell you, for my bids, I think it's all of them are 10,355.50 tambala. Who would do that? We don't know, but it's possible. So let's continue. The next one is how many radios are variable? So how many radios do you have? This is what? This is a number. So the next question is, what is the current total value of the radios? And this is a what? This is a decimal now. It's money. It's money. It's value of money. I hope we are together here at this point. I'm continuing. TV. Okay. How many TVs do you own? Another question. And this is a number. Okay. Then I say, what is the current total value of the TVs? Question mark. Add a question. And I say that this is a what? This is a decimal because this is money. Continue. Next one is bicycle. How many bicycles do you own? All right, and that's a number. So we go to the value question. So what is the current total value of all the bicycles? Okay, I have problems typing bicycles most of the times. Bicycle. Okay, that's decimal. Continue. Ox cart, right? So how many ox carts do you own? Obviously, you would first of all ask, do you have any ox carts? But what you would record is of how many. So this is the number. The next one is, what is the current total value of the ox carts? And that's a decimal because this is money. We are making good progress. Tables. I mean, good progress. Tables. How many tables do you own? That's a number. And then, what is the current total value of all the tables? I know I'm quick. Okay, but this is a video. You can stop me anytime. You can go back, rewind me anytime you want. You can slow motion me. It's up to you. So what the current total value for the table? That's decimal. And the last one is chairs. So how many chairs do you have? Question mark. Add question, and that's a number. That's a number. How many chairs? But for the next one, what is the current total value of all the chairs? You see? Add question, and that's decimal. We have done good. If you go to the questionnaire, you see that it's that section ends right there. Before I continue, I say, what do I do? I group. Perfect. You got it right. I group this. So starting with the first one, Control key, click the next one, the next one, the next one, the next one. I'm just gonna scroll a bit. I have more questions in here. So continue, 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 and the scroll, continue, continue. I still haven't left my control key. I'm still on my control key. I'm still on my control key. As I am clicking all this, oh my goodness, I have lost it. All right, so I'll start from the bottom. Okay, I'll start from there. This is what happens when you have a lot of questions in the section. It's you might actually find yourself clicking away from the group. and that escapes your selection and you have to start over. But it's all good, don't worry, it's all good. You'll lose a few seconds. That's fine, that's pretty fine. And then I've selected all, so I can go here and group. Okay, let's look at the label for that section. That section was coined household economic status. So I'll come on the group, select the group label, and say household economic status. We are doing good. And then what's next? Yeah, we have to do like that. So collapse the group to save space. Are we together at this point? I hope we're together. We are moving at the same space, at the same pace at this point. Okay, don't be worried, but I'm very sure that once you practice this as we are moving, you know, take it bite size, take the first section, understand it, and then move to the next one. I hope we are together at this point and it's actually working. Okay, so let's continue. All right, so we are finishing up. We're finishing up the next section. We are starting with how many rooms does your house have? Okay, so anyway, before I go there, I'm just gonna add a note again. So I'm just going to say, in the next questions, in the next set of questions, I would like to find out information concerning this house, this housing unit of yours. Question mark. So, no question mark. Sorry, no question mark. That is just a note. So it's gonna be, where is your note? Here. That's a note. So, next question, for first question actually in that section is, how many rooms does your house have? So, add how many rooms does your house have? So, that is what kind of that? That's a number, obviously. That's a number. Next question, how does your household dispose refuse? So, how does your household dispose refuse? Okay. And if you look at this question perfectly, again, this is a list of options. This is a list of options. But out of the options, we have collected, public dump, and then you have other here, and then you have specify other. If person enters that other, then we would like them to specify the other. So this specify other is going to be another question. Because now in this question, the person might answer other and they want to enter their value or their statement of the other kind of way in which they dispose of the refuse. So we need to take care of that. So this will be another question because it's going to want to have another value apart from this one. So we are going to have to put this specify other as a different question. I hope you understand that. But for the original question, you have a list of what? Options. That makes it a what? A multiple response or a select one. But for this one, they have to select one. They have to select one. They have to select the main reason way in which they dispose refuse. So that's going to make it a select one. So I'm going to select that it's a select one. And then the options there, collected, public dump. Public dump. And then you have dumped elsewhere. Continuing. Okay, burned by household. Think the simplest way, we just gonna be copying and pasting. Buried by household. Is that fast? I don't know. Let's see. Buried by household. Then we have other. Other. Okay, that's the end of it. I'm actually going to say one, two, 3, 4, 5, and 6. But I need a question where these people would have to select to specify other. Okay, I have to, you know, make this, you know, collapse it. I have to collapse this before I continue. So the other, I'll just do like this. I'll say other. Okay. Refuse. Okay, so I'll just say specify other refuse disposal, just like that. Refuse disposal. Specify other refuse disposal. Add question. This is obviously text because we're gonna now want them to add the text because we don't know the value, so they have to add it on their own. It's text. So the next question is what type of toilet is used by your household? I just copy this, and it also has specify if other. So let's do that. So what type of toilet? Add question. It's a select one. It's a select one, and the options are flush toilet, petrol drain. So flush toilet, petrol drain, pan or bucket. Do people actually use this? Oh my goodness, pan or bucket, and public toilet. Okay, public toilet, we have used this. And then toilet in another house. Okay. Toilet in another house. Wow. No toilet facility. Okay, so there's a bush or beach. Okay. I'm not going to say any comment about this one. So then we have other. Then we have other, and just as usual, I'm just gonna add my values, make it a habit to add the values, especially for SPSS, because it's gonna need some cleaning up to do when you bring it there. So adding the values helps it all. Okay, so there we have it, and we have the other. So what I would do is I'll just duplicate this question, this other question. Then I'm going to click, drag it down to reorder it, to arrange it. So can I drag down, please? Drag down. I can't drag it down. Okay. I think the best way is take this one and put it on the middle. There. I've reordered it. Have I? No. Reordering is a pain, but I think if I drop it there, it works. It has worked. I only have to change this label and say that type. Okay, for this one is type of toilet. So I'm going to say type of toilet. Not toilet. Toilet. Okay. Next question. What is the main construction? All right, what is the main construction of the floor? That's the last. Is it the last? No, we're gonna have other for the last one. So add question, and it's a select one as well. And what are the options? F mud bricks. I'm gonna just copy wood, and then we have stone there. Just keeping it in my head. Our heads are very small in RAM. I don't know. Are they? 256 KB. I have forgotten, you see, small RAM, very small RAM. So wood, stone, cement, or concrete. Stone. Cement / concrete. And the next one is band bricks and vinyl tiles. Band bricks. Vinyl tiles, ceramic marble. I'm just gonna copy this. This is a mouthful. Terrazzo other. So There we got it. And then we have terrazzo, and then we have other. And again, I'm just gonna, before I go, I'm just gonna have to put my values in. So 1, 2. Okay, and then I think I have the other specifier now. I'm just gonna do the same thing. I hope this one went, but I just have to do this first, and then I'm going to duplicate this question, and I'll take this, put it above that question. Ordered, yes. So I have this one specify other. I just have to edit this. It's not type of toilet. This is construct flow construction. For construction material done. So I save this. As it's saving, I'm going to create a group again. So this time I'm just gonna do the same thing, create a group. So select this, go to the toolbar, click there, and there I have it. I have done the same thing. I have left this, the note outside the group. I know I'm not going to repeat this question. This is not a roster. I'm not going to repeat this question. If you see this, it just looks like a table here, but it's not a roster. Because this is just a question and these are responses. Okay, it's the same thing even if I just remove the table thing here, but it's not a roster. So I'm not going to actually say that repeat, but I just want to keep this outside of the group. So that section is called housing. So I'm just gonna call this same way, housing. Save. At this point, we can say that we have finished. Okay, actually, I'm stretching myself right now. Okay, so we have finished creating the questions. All right, we've finished creating the questions. And the next thing we have to do is now look at skips and consistency checks. Are you ready for that? Let's look at the question in detail first. Sorry, not question, but the questionnaire in detail. Let's start from the beginning. So wherever we find consistency checks, we're going to put them before we go to the next one. So district, village, household number, no. Okay. But let's think about this household composition table. All right. Let's move together with me. What is the relationship of the name to the household head? Is this person male or female? What is the date of birth? Okay. Is this person married or not married? What was this person's highest education attained? Okay. Now, you see that we have date of birth, and then we have, is this person married or not married? Basically, I would say, if this person, say, is less than 16 years old of age, 16 is much older. But let's say if this person is 12 years of age, we don't want to ask that question. This is a household composition. So it means we're going to have a lot of children here. Say you have a kid who is just 3 months old. I don't think it's actually good to display this question of, is this person married or not married? I don't think so. So we're going to have to create an item for age. Okay, that is going to control. Okay, so from date of birth, then age will be calculated. All right, and then that will control whether we ask about married or not married, and also highest education attained. I don't think we would ask someone, a kid who is let's say 5 years old, about their education if we are starting at PSLCE, because PSLCE, obviously, it's maybe 10 years or above. That's when you would have PSLCE or equivalent. So let's create the age variable first. So the age variable is in section household composition. So I expand it, and then I look at when was this person born. Then I'll add in between here. You see, I have this in between here. I'll say how old is dollar A1. Remember the dollar A1? Remember that? If you don't remember, go back to the video. and just reverse me and make me start speaking again. I'm not gonna be tired because I'm recorded at this point. So add question, and then how old is a number? Obviously, this is a number. Okay, so I have my age variable, how old? So I want this question, is this person married or not married? So the person is the person that we are entering at this point in time. We don't want to ask this question for someone who is less than, but let's use less or equal to 12 years of age. Okay? So we don't, when this person is 12 years or less, we don't want to show whether this question of whether married or not married. I'm gonna say that again. This question, is this person married or not married? We don't want to show it if this person is not older than 12 years of age. In other words, if he or she is less than or equal to 12 years of age. So what I'll do is, because we are saying this question should only appear when this condition is met, then I'm going to go to that question in the settings, okay, and then in the skip logic, and then I'm going to add a condition. This condition controls whether this question appears or not. So I'm going to click this, okay? So it says this question will only be displayed if the following conditions apply. That's what we want to do. We only want this question to appear when one condition is met. And what's the condition? If this person is more than 12 years of age. If this person is more than 12 years of age, that's when this question appears. So I'll say, okay, we want this question to appear. So I scroll down so that I can see this age variable here. When the question of how old says is greater than 12. You see that? Okay, so that is it. So if this person is not 12 years, older than 12 years, this question doesn't appear. So I'm going to exit, okay, the settings. I have added my skill. I want to do the same thing with this question. What was A1's highest education attained? I only want this question because we're starting with PSLCE. So I only want this question to appear for anyone who is over 10 years of age. So I go to the settings of that question, then I go to skip logic, and I'm gonna say add a condition. What is the condition? I want this question to only appear when, so I scroll down, I still want this question of how old, when this question of how old is greater than 10. Okay, so it only asks for children who are 11, 12, 13, and above. All right, so this question won't appear if this condition is met, if the age variable is over 10 years. So I'm done with that one. All right, let's still continue with it. So I've finished with this one. So I'm continuing. I'll be adding skips. All right. If you look at now, we have how much income did you get from these sources? Okay, let's look at this question clearer. We have the first question, B3, which says, which of the following are your household's sources of income? All right. So if someone says salary from formal work is their source of income, that's the only time we want to show the question about the amount of salary they have got. If they did not select salary from formal work, I don't think we need to show them the question of how much money they received from as salary. I hope you agree. Great. So we are in agreement. So let's continue. So that question is in household economic status. So I'm going to expand that section. Then I come here and say, okay, we have how many people live in this household? And then we have how much, sorry, which of the following are your household source of income? This is the question. But how much income did you get from salary? This is the question I want to control, whether it should appear or not appear. So I go to the settings of that question. You see, how much income did you get from salary from formal work? Then I'll say skip logic. So I want this question to only appear when The last question, which is, which of the following are your household source of income, has salary selected? So I'll say add condition and select from the list the question. So the question that is being the controlling question is this one. Which of the following are your household sources of income? So I want this question to appear only when the question, which of the following are your household sources of income, there was a salary from former work selected. So equals salary from former work. You see that? So I close this. I'm going to do this again for this question, but this time, this question is, how much income did you get from wages? So I want this wages question to only appear if the person selected wages as their source of income on the question, which of the following are your household sources of income? Agree? Great. We're doing good. So let's go to the settings of the question, wages, how much money from wages, and go to skip logic. And then you say, add a condition. What will be the condition? The condition is such that this question, which of the following are your household source of income, was selected wages from Peaceway. I hope we are together. If you don't understand this part, go back, watch this again. I close this section. I want to do this again for the next question, which is, how much income did you get from sale of livestock and livestock products last year? So I'll go to the settings of this question and to skip logic. Then I'll say, I want this question to only appear, okay, add a condition, when the question of which of the following are your household sources of income, sale of livestock and livestock products has been selected. And by doing this, I just remember that I have skipped something. So this is a question of how much income did you get from livestock and livestock products? And I want this to appear when sale of livestock was selected. But then let me go back to sale of crops, which I think I skipped. I'm going to go to the settings of that question. Skip logic. I'm going to add the condition. For sale of crops, we want this to appear only when the person has selected sale of crops as one of the sources of cash income. Then, so what's the question? Which of the following are your household sources of income? By now, you might have realized that the questions that are popping up on this list are the questions above this question. Because only the questions above this question can control this question. Because if we select a question that is has not been entered yet, in other words, something that is after this question, then the skip is not valid at all. Okay, we want to evaluate something that has already been entered. So we want, which of the following are your household sources of income? This question is about crops. So we are going to say sale of crops. So we want this question here of how much income did you get from sale of crops to only appear when which of the following are your household source of income says sale of crops. I hope you understand there. I think we have one last, which is pension. So I go to the question pension and to skip logic. On this one, we are saying this person should only answer this question if which of the following are your household source of income is pension. When we do that, it means we are finished. Let me save. Let me actually click save so no horror happens. So there, I have done the skips. You see that? Exactly. So this is working well. This is working well. This is working perfectly well. Okay? It's working perfectly well. Okay. Now, I will now ask you about the items in your home and their values. So bed, you have how many available and current total value, and then you have radio. Now, think about it. If you ask someone, how many beds do you have? And they say zero. Do you really need to put the current total value? No, I don't think so. When someone tells you they don't have a bed, you don't want to ask them about current total value. So I want to do a skip on that too. So let's look at that question. Where is that question? How many beds do you have? This is okay. How many beds do you have and the person says zero. So if the person says zero on here, how many bits, we don't want this person to enter anything about what is the total current value of the bets. So what do? We go to the settings of this question and we say skip logic and we say add condition. So let's think about this. We are saying we want this question, what is the current total value of the bets, to only appear when bets is not zero. Okay, you could say when bet is greater than zero, same thing, all right, or you know, something like that. But for this one, I'm just gonna just preference. So this question only appears when how many bets you have is greater than zero, or we could say is not zero. This is the same thing, which is the same thing. It's up to you. You can select is greater than zero, or you can say is not zero. It's up to you. I do the same thing with the next one. How many radios do you have? We don't want to ask the question of the total value of radios when the person just said he has zero radios. So skip logic. I'm going to say this question only appears when how many radios do you have is not zero. Are we together here? Yes, we are together. Thank you very much. Now, next question. What is the, how many TVs do you own? How many TVs do you own? What is the total current value of the TVs? This question doesn't appear if the how many TVs is zero. So we say this question is only going to appear if the question of how many TVs do you own is not zero. So if it's not zero, then it's going to appear anything but not zero. Okay, so how many bicycles, what is the total current value of bicycles? So I go the same way, skip logic, add the condition, and I'll say this question only appears, okay, this question only appears if the question of how many bicycles do you own is not zero. I hope we are moving together pretty well. Oxcuts. What is the total current value of oxcuts? Skip logic. Add a condition. What is the total current value of oxcuts? Only appears if how many oxcuts do you own is not zero. All right. Same thing with the next one. Chairs. No. Tables. What's the total current value of tables? This question of tables, of current total value of tables, does not appear. Sorry, it appears only when how many tables do you own? It only appears when how many tables you own is not zero. If it's not zero, then it will appear. If it's zero, no, it doesn't appear. How many chairs? Then total current value of chairs. I do the same thing. Skip logic. This question appears only when the last question, which is how many chairs do you own, is not zero. Done. And I'm just going to save this. You see? We are doing good. We are doing perfectly good here. I'm going to do the last skips, which is how does your household dispose refuse? And we're talking about questions of other. You know, we have these options right here for this question. How does your household dispose refuse? And we have collected, public dump, dumped elsewhere, burned by household, buried by household, and other. So when the person selects collected, we don't want them to put specify other. We only want them to put specify other if they say that they haven't found any on this list and it's actually other. Okay, I hope you understand that part. So specify other only appears if this question was other selected. So let's do that. So this question is in housing, perfectly fine. So we have this other question may appear or may not appear at what conditions. So we go to the settings, then it says skip logic, and we say add condition. So this question of other refuse disposal only appears if the last question, which is how does your household dispose refuse, other was selected. So equals other. So if it's equals other, that's when this question appears. If it's not other, then it doesn't need to appear. Close that. So this is how you do skips. The next one is specify other type of toilet. So I'm going to do the same thing, go to the settings, and I'm going to say skip logic, add a condition. So this question of other types of toilet appear only when the type of toilet is other. So when the person says other, that's when this question of now what other, tell us. And then that's when it is going to appear. The last one is actually floor construction material. Other floor construction material there. So I go to skip logic, add a condition, and say the condition is such that this thing or this question appears only when what is the main construction of the floor is other. Done. Close the settings. Save. You see? So within a short period of time, I have finished dealing with skips and creating the questionnaire. Done. I just want to do one last thing. Just give me some moment. One last thing. I'd like to talk about, I'm just going to do consistencies. I'm just going to do consistency. And I have two consistencies I have to look at. Okay? If you look at this questionnaire, the first consistency is of age. We have put, there's no age variable here, but we have put age. Okay? We just want to make sure that age does not, the person does not input anything over 110 years old. Okay, 110 years in age. And that question is under household composition. So how old is $A1? So we want to make sure that we don't have errors whereby this person enters a huge number like over 110. I'm just putting 110 as my cut point. So how old is A1? I go to the settings and we say, okay, for this one, the skip logic goes as follows. No, it's not a skip logic. It's validation. We would like to validate this question. How do we say that this question is valid? We want this question to only be valid. So we're going to say add condition. So the response for this question is only going to be valid if it is less than or equal to 110. This is the science. If someone is over 110 years old, then this the age is not valid. I don't think we have anyone who is over 110 years of age. Okay? So basically, we just want to control that someone would enter something that is way out of age. Okay, out of the ages that we normally have. So this question is only valid when it's less than or equal to 110. Okay, so if it's greater than 110, then what should happen? We should flash an error message. We'll say invalid age. Please check and re-enter. Just like that. I hope you're going to be a good error message writer. You don't make people faint. Because I know some of you might be actually contemplating of putting something really, out of line. Like, are you drunk? Why are you putting something that is greater than 110 years? Are you drunk? All right. It's okay if you didn't laugh. Okay, so how old is $A1? We have said the validation criteria is such that this question is not over 110 years old, or 110 years. Okay. In that example, I was only using the value of that same variable. Let's talk about the last thing I want to talk about here, which is now here, where we have section B, questions B1 and B2. B1, we're asking about how many people live in the household. How many people live in the household? And then the next question says, of this, how many actively contribute to the income of the family? So I expect that if how many people in the household is, say there are 10 people in the household, I expect the number of people who are actively economically active in the household is either 10, that is all the people, or less than 10, but not more than 10. But you know what? People who are, you know, they have those tablets, you know, they're in there flashing them where they're, you know, villagers, you know, they're pompers. Okay, just some, not all. And they have forgotten that they're asking questions and they might just enter some number, you know, or they want to put 10 and then accidentally they just put 100, for example. We want to control for that because we don't want to do other form of data cleaning after that. So what do? We want to restrain that this question B2, how many actively contribute to the income of the family, should at any point be equals or less than the number of people in the household. So how do we deal with that? Okay, this is how we deal with that. I'm going to go to the section that is this is household economic status. So the first two questions, how many people live in this household? That's fine. So the person enters, okay, 10. Now the next question is, how of this, how many actively contribute to the income of the family? Now that's where I have things to do. So I go to my validation criteria, okay? And now, if you remember when we are entering the validation criteria for age, it did not ask us anything about another variable, okay? So if I go to add condition here, it's not going to help. It's not going to help because I want to evaluate what has been entered on of this with the previous question, which is how many people live in the household. So for this, I'm going to have to use manually enter your validation. And they have even just gave you, you know, the syntax of the question referencing format here, which is actually a good thing to do. But because I'm going to need to refer to this question, I need to know the data column name of that question. So I'm just going to delete this and make it simple. So I'm just going to say, HH number. I'm just going to give it as HH number. That's household number. People have number of people in the household. So that it's easily, and then I'll just copy it so that it's so easy to remember. Close it. So I go back. So I was just copying the data column name of how many people live in this household. So at this point, I want now to control this. Okay. So what do? I say manually enter your validation logic. Just give me a blank space here and it's just me and no one else. And I have to type that. So what do I want? I want this question. Okay. I want the value of this question to not be anything greater than the last question. In other words, I want this question to be either equal or less to the last question. That's what I want. I want this question to be less or equal to the last question. So this in ODK is full stop. So this question less equal to the last question. What is the last question? Last question is dollar, open curl bracket. I'm going to paste HH number, cross curl bracket. You see what has happened? So now this question shall always be less or equal. If it's greater, if the person has entered something greater than the last one, then we say that the number of economically active people, active people cannot be greater, or let's say cannot exceed the total number of people in the household. Please, you know, it doesn't matter whether this guy is actually drunk, but please is good. You know, it's good to be humble and you know, of good behavior. So please re-enter. Done. I save this. Voila. I've saved this. And trust me, we have finished. We have grouped our questions. We have done skip commands. And then we have done consistency checks. We have finished creating this questionnaire. Unless otherwise you want to add, for example, languages, which is going to need us to export this to Excel. But for this one, I'm not going to do that. So I'm just going to close. Before I close, you may want to check this. So if you were running along, just click this button here and check if everything is perfect. Check if everything is perfect. Right now, I'm just going to close. It's actually good as you develop it. Check if your skips are happening and so on. I'm just going to close this. Because now I have finished developing my form, I have to deploy it. The next thing to do when you have finished developing your form is to deploy it. Okay, we want to deploy. So this is my form right now, and I just want to deploy it the way it is. It's actually good. We have 47 questions. I'm actually so good. So how do we deploy? When we are here, we just click this play button, deploy, and I click that, and I wait. Deployed form. That's it. So the form has been deployed. I wait until I am redirected to this. Now, this is the aggregator where the data is going to be. So I have zero submissions, as you can see here. I have zero submissions. Okay, zero submissions. That means I haven't entered anything. Before I go, I just want to tell you that we have project settings here. For example, I can turn off if I don't want to receive any submissions from any phones. I can add some form files and so on. All right, so that's it. So, at this point, I can share the project publicly if I want. I can share the data publicly so people can just come in without the passwords and enter if they want. I can share this project with other users as well. So, I just have to look for the users in Coco Toolbox and I can share with them. So I can add users here. But right now, that's not what I want to do. All what I want to do is now start collecting data. So let's hop over to our phone. So now we can talk about, we can see how we can enter the data. So right now I'm outside of my office. You cannot see me, but I'm actually outside of my office. And what I want to do is I want to now try to enter some information, some data, and see if I can now get the same data in my server, in my account. Okay, so first thing you do is make sure that you have on this link, on this menu here, make sure you have gone to General Settings. And on Configure Platform Settings, make sure you have inputted your details of your Kobo Toolbox account, the username and the password which you used when you were creating your questionnaire. Next thing is I like to go to AutoSend and select that I'm going to AutoSend the data when Wi-Fi or mobile internet is available in my phone. And lastly, when in navigation, I like to make sure that I use swipes and buttons both. So I make sure that those things are on. So I'm going to go back. So now what I need to do is to download the form that I deployed. To download it, I just have to go to get blank form. And then I'm going to wait so that it connects to the server. You see that it has listed all the forms that I have deployed. I'm just going to deselect all these and make sure I only have household service selected. I'll say get selected. Okay, so I'm going to wait until it gets this form. Okay, so it's getting the form. And then the download result means it has got the form, which means now I can say fill blank form. Okay, so now go to household survey. The form is loading. Okay, so let's wait. The form has loaded. So this would be in the field now, and you are with a household, and then you have loaded the form. So I can navigate to district. So I can say, for example, this is Chikwawa. The village is Taba.
Household number, this is one. GPS, now because I'm outside, I will be able to collect the GPS without a problem. So let's wait until the GPS is located. Make sure you don't move or about. GPS recorded with 4.4 meters accuracy. That's good. Next, so in the next section, I'm going to ask you about you, and so you are reading out to the person, to the respondent. So next, this is now the roster, the repeating section. So ad group, what's the name of this member of a household? So the first person is the head of the household, Peter Chira. Then what is the relationship itself? Is Peter Chira male or female? This is actually male. What's the date? So I can click 2016 and now type, this is 1990 okay, sorry about that. 1990, so in January 14, next. How old? Okay, for that time, should be 26 years old. Peter Chira married? Yes, married. Education, MSCE. Add yes, add another group. What's the next member? Next member is Martha Chira. And the relationship spouse, female. Born the same year, 1990, July 4. How old? Should be 26, the same. Married and MSCE as well. Want to add another one? Yeah, they have a little girl. The name is Joanna. Joanna. Joanna Chira. Okay. So what's the relationship? It's a child. It's female. And so she's born last year. Last year in July 5, which means only 1 year old. And look what happens. What was Joanna Chira's highest education attained? Underage. Okay. And the married question did not come. Want to add group? Not do or not do not add. So how many people live in this household? There are three people. This, how many actively contribute? If I say four, okay, which is above three, it's going to give me that error. So I only have to say two, because these are the economically active people. So two. So this question, remember, is the question where we have a skip. So these people only get salary from former work and sale of crops. And watch what happens. If I go next, how much income did you get from salary? 456,000. How much income did you get from sale of crops? It's 258,000, you see, and the other ones have been skipped. I'll now ask you about items in your household and their values. Next, how many beds? They have one bed with the value of 35,000, and they have one radio at a value of 25,000. Okay, but they don't have a TV, so that's zero. So it's not going to ask me the next question of why. Of value. So it's just asking me of how many bicycles you own. They don't have a bicycle. So the next happens, how many Oscars? They don't have an ox cart. How many tables? They have one table, which is valued at 12,000. And next, how many chairs? They have four chairs at a value of 12,000. So the next set of questions, this is the not, if you remember. I'd like to find out information concerning this housing unit. So how many rooms does it have? It has five rooms. How does your household dispose refuse? They have a public dump. Type of toilet, it says Peter Twin. And what is the main construction? So let's say we don't have things. You might have seen that the last questions, it was not asking me about the other, because we have put a skip there. So if I select other, this one, for example, let's say it's bamboo, then next is going to ask me about other, so I can say bamboo. Bamboo for this one. Then at the end of the survey, I can actually click save, form and exit, and what's gonna happen is I have sent finalized form, but it has just gone. Why? Auto sent. It has been auto sent. It's gone.
Okay, now I'm here on the window of the aggregator. Okay, so what I'll do is I'll refresh and see if I have my submissions already. You see that I have three actually I should have four submissions. You see that? I have four submissions. So what I'll do is, for example, I can view this data in a table. I can view this data in a table. So this is my data. You see that? All these questions. Which of the following are your household source of income? How much income did you get from what? How much income did you get from? What is the total current value of what? This is my data. I'm just going to return to the household survey. Okay. I can analyze this data right away. And this is very powerful. This is very powerful. As you can see, already it has created tables and it's actually creating graphs. So you see this? This is your page. This is GPS. And then you have here, which of the following are your household source of income, salary from, you know, you have all those graphs. It's going to be very interesting when you do your own questionnaire right there. This is actually how it gets. So all people are from Chikwao. We don't have anyone from the other districts because this is what I entered. Okay, you can go to household survey. Apart from that, what else can I do? So I can view this data on a map. I can view this data on a map, so I can wait a bit until the data loads, my data loads. You see that? This is my data. So let's see. Let's wait until the map, the base map appears. Okay, I think I'm experiencing low internet connection. Okay, I'm experiencing low internet connection. I'm not able to get the map. But try it and you actually see that you have a base map there and your points appearing on the map. It's very interesting. It's very, very interesting. Exactly. Now that's what I'm talking about, except I don't think it has loaded perfectly. I can change the map by just going here. Let's say I want a Google. Okay, we can say, let's say Google satellite. Let's select a Google satellite map. Beautiful. You see? So if you see here, this is it. This is the Rilongo River. And this is the ADD. This is where my office is. I just stood outside. Remember, I told you I'm outside my office. This is my office right here. This is this here is actually the car park. So my office is situated right here. You just go around the car park, and then this is the building where my office is. And then this is the road. Okay, the road going outside. This is a golf club, and then you go outside. This is supposed to be, I think, Eskom, okay, and then, oh, no, anyway, this is not what we're talking about. Then I could, this is a new building that is being built right there, and you have the roundabout going right there. Okay, and the analysis is nice, you know, you can do the analysis nicely here, as you can see, but I have just 4 points of data. It won't be that interesting. Okay, so let's go back. Our thing is we can now download the data. So exporting the data, I just download. I'll select advanced downloads. Say advanced downloads. This is the fastest I have seen and the beta one. You know, don't worry about the settings. Just hit download. And what will happen is it will create this household survey and what, and then I can say open with Excel. I just want to open directly. So it downloads and then Excel opens up. Now I want you to see that we have the data. Okay, we have the data. And I've selected that I want the labels, not the values. Okay, if you want to bring it into SPSS, you would want to select values, not labels. So that you don't have values, but rather you have labels. So if you go here, you see that this is actually my data right here. If you have a lot of it's going to be very interesting stuff. If you have a lot of data, you can see there, oh, these are my data. Nicely there. You know, I don't have another way of explaining it. This is brilliant. Thank you. So that's it for this lesson. And thank you very much. See you next weekend. If you are watching this after we have finished the training, then please keep on practicing.